Good morning and God bless you. We're delighted to have you with us here this morning. This morning, we felt like bringing a blast from our archives. I think you're going to be greatly blessed. You know, oftentimes the ministry is placed on a pedestal of infallibility, but the Word of God just doesn't seem to support that. In fact, even in James chapter 5, it reminds us that even Elijah, the great prophet of old, was a man subject to like passions as we are. But I think that there is an understanding and a revelation in this that will be a great blessing to you. So God bless you as you view this. We look forward to seeing you Monday morning. Good morning and God bless you. We're delighted to have you with us here this morning. Perhaps this is your first time tuning in and viewing this, and we want to extend a welcome to you. We want to begin with prayer. We want to continue to pray for our president and our nation that are in troubling times. We also want to continue to pray for our local community that God will open up doors of opportunity. And we want to continue to pray for Cornerstone Pentecostal Church. Perhaps you have a special request. This is a perfect time to make that known unto God. Let's pray together. Father, we love you. We praise you. We worship you. Father, we thank you for the abundance of all things. We want to continue to pray for our president. You will build a hedge of protection around him. And God, we pray for our nation that is experiencing troubling times. We pray for the perfect will of God to be done. Father, we also want to pray for our local community that you will continue to open up doors of utterance that we can communicate this great truth. And we pray for Cornerstone Pentecostal Church that you will open up the windows of heaven and pour out provision, protection, and your presence. We ask all of this in the name above every name, the name of Jesus Christ. And everybody said, amen. I want to draw your attention this morning to an extremely important passage of scripture. It's found in 2 Samuel chapter number 6. 2 Samuel chapter number 6. I'm sorry, we're at 2 Samuel 7. 2 Samuel 7 and verse number 1. My mistake right there is going to underscore what we're going to talk about here. Verse number 1, and it came to pass when the king sat in his house, and the Lord had given him rest round about from all his enemies, that the king said unto Nathan the prophet, see now, I dwell in a house of cedar, but the ark of God dwelleth within curtains. And Nathan said to the king, go, do all that is in thine heart, for the Lord is with thee. I want to talk to us for a few moments this morning on this important subject, when the ministry misses it. When the ministry misses it. Here, the Ark of God is safely back in Jerusalem after initially falling into the hands of the Philistines and then spending a certain amount of time at Obed-Edom's. And then you remember the story about them placing the ark on a new cart and what happened there. But now the ark has been brought back to Jerusalem. David is sitting in his house and he's looking at how grand and glorious his house is. But the Ark of the Covenant, which is a representation of the presence and the law of God, dwelleth in a tent. Standing by David when he makes this statement is Nathan the prophet that makes this statement. Go do all that is in thine heart, and the Lord, for the Lord is with thee. David wanted to build a fitting place for the presence of God. He wanted to build God a house. And Nathan immediately responded by saying, go and do all that is in thine heart, for the Lord is with thee. Except that that night, and it came to pass that night, that the word of the Lord came unto Nathan, saying, go and tell my servant David, thus saith the Lord, shalt thou build me an house for me to dwell in? Now therefore, so shalt thou say unto my servant David, thus saith the Lord of hosts, I took thee from the sheep cote, from following the sheep, to be ruler over my people, over Israel. So on and so forth, continues God speaking to Nathan the prophet. And basically, the message was that David was to not build a house for God, but God would establish his throne and his lineage forever. And so Nathan goes in to talk to David, and it includes, but my mercy shall not depart away from him as I took it from Saul, whom I put away from thee. And thine house and thy kingdom shall be established forever before thee. Thy throne shall be established forever. According to all these words and according to all this vision, so did Nathan speak unto David. Then went King David in and sat before the Lord and said, who am I, O Lord God? And what is my house that thou hast brought me hitherto? Incredible portion of scripture. David intended to build God a house. The prophet thought that was a great idea and said, go and do it. God's with you. And then God spoke to the prophet at night and said, David will not build me a house, but I will establish his throne forever. The prophet missed it. He had good intentions. He was caught up with the inspiration of the moment. Surely God would be behind such a grand plan for this, the greatest king in the history of Israel. A warrior, a psalmist, a visionary, a man that loved God's people and God's plan and program in the earth. And yet the prophet missed it. But David never held it against the prophet for missing it. In fact, Nathan comes back and gives David what God did say. And David responded by immediately going into the house of God and worshiping and talking to God. Not only this, but at the most important juncture in the life of David was not the horn of oil that was opened up by Samuel and then placed over the top of David's head, but it was when Nathan was used to bring the great king to repentance after David had killed one of his mighty men of valor and taken his wife, and then through deceit had this great man placed with an arrow shot from the walls. If David had held that one mistake, that one error against Nathan the prophet, Nathan could not have been used to bring to David one of the greatest prophecies in the Word of God. In fact, when Gabriel, the archangel, appeared unto Mary, it was a fulfillment of this very prophecy, because he talked about him that will come will also sit on the throne of David. And so this was an enduring prophecy that went beyond David's failure, went beyond David's adultery, went beyond David's murder. It continued to go beyond his mistakes. And it was brought to him by a prophet that had made a mistake. You know, the ministry today is under incredible scrutiny from within and without. And I'll be honest with you, I am a pastor. I love what I'm doing. I love God. I love people. I love the work of God. I love everything about this. I love my calling. But ladies and gentlemen, sometimes even a pastor with the best of intentions can make a mistake. Not on purpose, not premeditated, not something that's done in the back rooms and the dark places within a church to try to fool God's people or to hurt God's people. But sometimes there just can be a mistake, a wrong call. Don't hold it against the ministry, because he could be used to bring a prophecy. and could be used to bring you to the greatest point of repentance in your life. God bless you. Thank you for joining us here this morning. We look forward to seeing you tomorrow.